Peki.
Söz sizde hocam. Teşekkürler.
Okay, let me share screen first. Share screen. Okay, so can you see the screen?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. So I think this will be the last lecture for preparations. I have two more lectures. The fourth one I'm going to discuss spinors, and then in the fifth one I'm going to discuss variational techniques for Fermi fields. What happens if I have a spinorial field equations? How can I drive it by variations? There are subtle points there, and in order to appreciate those subtle points, I have to go over the notion of Clifford algebras, and in particular I'm going to discuss the Clifford algebras over the cotangent bundle on spacetime and the spin group. But in general, we can define the Clifford algebra for any vector space over the real numbers. So suppose V is an n-dimensional real vector space, and suppose that it is equipped with a non-degenerate symmetric bilinear quadratic form. Namely, it is just a bilinear map from the tensor product V cross V into R, such that for all our x, y vectors in the vector space, the quadratic form evaluates to a real number. And in fact, this quadratic form induces a norm on the vector space. If you take both entries to be the same vector, g of xx gives me a quadratic form for any x in the vector space. I haven't said anything about the definiteness of the symmetric bilinear quadratic form. So this is a norm, but at this point it need not be positive definite. If the metric has a positive definite signature, Riemannian case, in which case the norm will be positive definite. Otherwise, at this point, since I'm not specified, I haven't specified G any further at this point, this is a norm, but which need not be positive definite. And then the converse is also true, that we should also point this out, that if you specify a norm on B, that's to say if the magnitude of any vector on V is given, zero, plus or minus, as the case may be, the norm provides the vector space with a non-degenerate symmetric quadratic form defined by the polarization identity. And this is a well-known identity. You can think about it in terms of Euclidean space. If you take the norm of vector x plus y, and then if you subtract from that the norm of x and the norm of y, then what remains is twice the inner product of these two vectors. An inner product induces a norm. Conversely, a norm induces an inner product. Now the product of two vectors will be understood as the tensor product. A tensor product, a tensor, what's a tensor? Maybe I should give the equation of a tensor at this point. A tensor is an object, which is a map, which is a multilinear map, from the product of n vector spaces, V tensor, V tensor, V n times, into the set of real numbers. So what you have is an object with n slots. To each slot, you assign a vector. Then this object eats all these vectors in that given order and gives you back a real number. And then in each vector, it is linear. So a tensor is a multilinear map. And this is a second rank tensor. It means that if you take a vector x from the first vector, if you take a vector y from the second vector, then you get the tensor product xy, which lives in this tensor space, in this product space. And in general, the order of the tensor product is important. the product tensor product yx is not necessarily equal to x tensor y. Now, so we have multilinear maps of rank p. These are not these do not form an algebra on their own, but if you consider the direct sum of all tensors of all ranks over V, then you get the tensor algebra. So here we have a sum on P starting from zero going up to infinity at this point, infinite dimension. So if you take a tensor of rank P, which is a multilinear map from the product of P vector fields into the set of real numbers, if you take the direct sum over all tensors of rank P, then that's what you get is a tensor algebra. P equals zero, it's a map from reals to reals. The identity map lives in this first slot. And then we have the vector space itself. This is the direct sum. And then you take the direct sum to second with the second rank tensors, direct sum with the third rank tensors, and you go on like that. So this is the tensor algebra, and each factor in this direct sum will be a tensor of rank P. Now, so in order to make this clear, I think let me just take a basis of vectors in V. We have an n-dimensional vector space. I'm going to show a basis by elements gamma A upstairs, but A running from 1 to n. And I can, since I'm given an inner product, bilinear, symmetric bilinear quadratic form on V, I can also take the basis to be orthonormal with respect to this product. That's to say, I'm going to choose my basis vectors in such a way that if I take the quadratic, their inner product, they are either plus or minus one, because I'm not saying anything about the definiteness at this point. So the norm of basis vectors are either plus or minus one, they form an orthogonal basis. We can always do that. We know this from the theory of vector spaces. Now, a generic Clifford algebra element that I'm going to call A this is the notation. The Clifford algebra is determined in terms of the vector space that I use, initial vector space, and the norm Q, the quadratic form, defined norm defined on that vector space. And a typical vector element can be a Clifford algebra element, can be written in this form, in this given orthonormal basis. Remember that it's a tensor algebra element. And now we are restricting our tensor algebra element to an element of a generic Clifford algebra, Clif VQ. So it starts with a set of real numbers. So I put a real number alpha. And then we have the vector space itself. So vector space element, any vector is expanded in the spaces. So I have an index A1 that's summed over here. And then plus, that's the key point here. You have an anti-symmetric tensor product of two basis elements. So when I put these two indices between square brackets, it means that those indices are totally anti-symmetrized. So I have gamma A1, A2 between square brackets. That means that this is gamma A1 times gamma A2 minus gamma A2 times gamma A1. And I saturate that with real coefficients. Since I have assumed summation convention, I sum over A1 on the full range, I sum over A2 on the full range, and in order to avoid double counting, I normalize by 1 over 2 factorial. And the next term is quite obvious. You will anti-symmetrize the tensor product of T three basis elements, you will have real coefficients with three indices, and then you sum over all these three indices and you normalize with 1/3 factorial. And in fact, I come up to n, the dimension of the vector space is n. So at the end, I will have a base, a tensor product of n basis elements, orthonormal basis elements. And then this is a tensor product, which is totally anti-symmetrized in n indices. And then I have some coefficients, real coefficients. And since I'm summing over n indices, I normalize by 1/n factorial. Now, is there anything else I have to add on to that one? Now, the Clifford algebra elements are defined by such an expansion over the totally anti-symmetrized tensor products of an elements of an orthonormal basis of the vector space. It's an n-dimensional vector space. So the next element would be such that there will be a product of n plus one basis elements, gamma one, gamma two, up to gamma n plus one, but there is no gamma n plus one. There are n orthonormal basis elements. And if you want to consider the product of n plus one basis elements anti-symmetrized, that will be identically zero. So the Clifford algebra expansion, the expansion of the Clifford algebra element, any Clifford algebra element in a given G orthonormal basis is a finite sum. It stops at the nth element. This is the leading element, is zero, zero rank. This is the top element, the nth rank. And in between, I have all the tensor products, tensors, given, and this is the vector space. This is V cross V, V cross V cross V, etc. And this is the top element. So all the coefficients in the expansion should be real. And then for any positive integer P, we have this anti-symmetrization. It can be given also in this way. Anti-symmetrization can be given by a single represented. This anti-symmetric product can be represented by a single element. If you order the indices in the increasing order, A1 is strictly less than A2, strictly less than A3, etc., strictly less than AP, then if you take this product, gamma A1, gamma A2, etc., gamma AP, with this strict ordering given, then this is the unique element that you use in this expansion. Now, of course, I can also introduce at this point a Levi-Civita symbol, the epsilon symbol for total anti-symmetrization. This epsilon A1 up to AP is a numerical tensor of rank P, which is totally skew symmetric. If any, the value of any two indices repeats itself, that identically vanishes. All the indices should take distinct values. Depending on whether the indices, the order of the indices is an even permutation of 1 to P, 1 to 3 P. If it is an even permutation of that particular ordering, it's plus. If you have an odd permutation of the sequence 1, 2, 3 up to P for the index values, that will be minus. So the epsilon tensor takes only two values, either plus 1 or minus 1. And then if any index value repeats itself, it vanishes. Using this epsilon symbol, you can express the skew symmetric product of the basis elements of the vector space as using the summation convention over P indices. And you have to be always careful to have this normalization factor to avoid overcounting at this point. This is more familiar way of giving the vector space in an orthonormal basis, since we have a symmetric bilinear form, non-degenerate symmetric bilinear form defined on the vector space. And then when I talk about the Clifford algebra over the vector space V with the given norm induced by the symmetric bilinear, non-degenerate symmetric bilinear form, you should always remember this expansion. This is the generic Clifford algebra element. Well, I say that it's an algebra, so I have to provide a rule for its the multiplication of two elements in that Clifford algebra. So if I am given any other Clifford algebra element B with a similar expansion here, I define something that I call the Clifford product. It's not the wedge product, it's a Q-symmetric product. This is a Clifford product, V product. And what you do is, it's quite a tedious business. You take the Clifford algebra element A with this expansion. I have elements of all types here, basis elements, and a similar expansion for B. When you take the Clifford product of A and B, you just multiply each term with each other. But when you have to be very careful, because if you want the Clifford product AVB to be also in the Clifford algebra itself, then you have to do something. You have to take, for instance, alpha, that's the leading term in the expansion of A. And so you multiply each element in the expansion of B with alpha, that's well defined. But what are you going to do if you come to the next element, A? Alpha A, gamma A. You take this element and you multiply with each element in the expansion of B. So you have, the first term is obvious. It is alpha A beta times gamma A. But the next term, alpha A beta B, gamma A gamma B. In order to have something that lies in the Clifford algebra, you have to anti-symmetrize this product. Otherwise, it's not in the Clifford algebra basis. So you, instead of gamma A, gamma B, you introduce, I'm going to show it on the board. So it's a very tedious product here because A is an expansion over these anti-symmetric products of the basis elements. B is an expansion in the anti-symmetric product of these expansion terms, over these terms. When you consider the Clifford product, you multiply each term with itself. But when you have a product of a basis of products of P gammas and a product of Q gammas, then when you take the tensor product, you totally skew symmetric the whole product. So that's the skew symmetric tensor product. I think it's best understood in a simple case. First of all, let me just give you a proposition here. Now the Clifford algebra over an n-dimensional vector space equipped with a norm induced from a non-degenerate bilinear quadratic form, Clif VQ. We call gamma A's the generators of the Clifford algebra. Remember, gamma A's are the basis, orthonormal basis elements of the vector space. We call those the generators of the Clifford algebra. There are n of those. And that basis induces, these generators induce a basis for the Clifford algebra given by these anti-symmetric tensor product of these basis elements. And if you count the number of independent elements in this set, you will see that the dimension of the Clifford algebra over an n-dimensional vector space will be 2 to the n. You can prove this identity. But in order to make everything clear, I think let me go to the simple case of a three-dimensional Euclidean space. So we have the vector spaces R3, familiar, and we put on that the usual Euclidean metric. And then I introduce an orthonormal basis. Let me call it gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3. So it's an orthonormal basis relative to the Euclidean metric on this R3. Means that gamma 1 square, gamma 2 square, gamma 3 square all are equal to 1. There is the identity of the real set. And then the product of the basis elements should be skew symmetric tensor product. Gamma 1, gamma 2 should be minus gamma 2, gamma 1. Gamma 1, gamma 3 is minus gamma 3, gamma 1. And we have these skew symmetric products. And of course, the product of gammas are associative. So I can take, for instance, gamma 1. I multiply gamma 1 with gamma 1, gamma 2. Gamma 1 square gamma 2, which is gamma 2. But if I multiply this with gamma 3, gamma 3, gamma 1, gamma 3, I can write it as gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, which is an independent Clifford algebra element. Now you see that this is something different. This is not writing the Cartesian basis for the Euclidean vector space. I'm writing the Clifford algebra basis, and the Clifford algebra basis elements are orthonormal. However, the fact that they anti-commute, they are matrices, in fact. Let me come back to this one. So the Clifford algebra basis for the Clifford algebra on R3, equipped with the usual Euclidean metric, consists of this 8 elements, 1, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, and the product of two matrices, 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 3, and then gamma 1, 2, 3. So if I considered a Clifford algebra element, it should be an expansion of this type here. A0, there will be 8 coefficients, real coefficients, A0, A1, up to A7. And if I take a second Clifford algebra element, B, then the expansion coefficients are running from B0, B1, up to B7. Then the point is, take their Clifford product, A, Clifford product, B. What does it mean? It should be a Clifford algebra element. Again, it should be an expansion of this type. And then C0, you have to work it out tediously because I have given you the rules. So for instance, A0, B0, it should be included in C0, but A0, B1 is not. But on the other hand, A1, B1 should be also included. A2, B2 should be included, etc. So here it is. I have C0 given as A0, B0, A1, B1, A2, B2, A3, B3. Now, what about A4, B4? A4, B4. A4, B4 should be included, but on the other hand, I have gamma 1, 2 times gamma 1, 2 in the here. Well, what's gamma 1, 2, gamma 1, 2? Well, this is gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 1, gamma 2, skew symmetrized, right? I haven't put square brackets, but it is skew symmetric. So this is in fact gamma 1, gamma 2, minus gamma 2, gamma 1. This is gamma 1, gamma 2, minus gamma 2, gamma 1, right? So, and also you remember that gamma 1, gamma 2 anti-commute. So you can show that gamma 1, 2 squares to minus 1. And similarly for gamma 1, 3 and gamma 2, 3, they square to minus 1. And you can also show that gamma 1, 2, 3, gamma 1, 2, 3 is the skew, is the anti-symmetrized product. Gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, and then pluses for 3, symmetric permutations of gamma 1, 2, 3, gamma 3, gamma 1, gamma 2, plus gamma 2, gamma 3, gamma 1, and then gamma 3, gamma 2, gamma 1 comes with a minus sign, etc. So there are 6 terms involved here, another 6 terms involved here, and then you can show that when you take the square of gamma 1, 2, 3, it gives you minus. So look here, C0, I have calculated C0. It contains 8 elements, the product of real numbers, they are all well defined, but 4 of them comes with plus, 4 of them comes with minus. Now, calculating C7 is also, C7, the last one, is also not so difficult because I can pick up those terms. For instance, when I take the Clifford product A, B, B, A, so C7 will contain A0 times B7. It contains A7 times B0. These are the obvious elements. But on the other hand, A1, gamma 1, should contribute with B6, right? It shouldn't contribute with B5. It shouldn't contribute with B4. But it should contribute with B6. You can just work this out. It's a very tedious calculation, but the rest of the coefficients can be determined by similarly by these long computations. So what I have to say is that given a basis for the orthonormal basis for the vector space, I introduce a Clifford algebra basis by the anti-symmetrized products of these basis elements. Then a Clifford algebra element can be given as an expansion over these anti-symmetric products of these basis elements. It's just a tensor sum. And then I can give you a well-defined Clifford product rule. So it's an algebra. I can add two numbers, Clifford algebra elements. I can take the product of two Clifford algebra elements, and I can just develop all the rules that are used for Clifford algebra elements. Now, there are all sorts of complications here. It's not easy. I have given you this simple example so that you will be familiar with what's going on. It's still, even in the simplest case, the calculations are tedious, but not very difficult. Tedious, but not very difficult. Now, in our physical applications, the vector space that we consider, it's going to be the cotangent bundle. We are working on the four-dimensional Minkowski spacetime, which is given by the triplet, a four-dimensional differentiable manifold, the spacetime manifold, and it's equipped by this non-degenerate second-rank covariant metric tensor of Lorentzian signature minus plus plus plus, and then usually we don't show this connection, the rule for parallel transport, usually for Riemannian spacetimes or pseudo-Riemannian spacetimes, but I think we should keep it there because it's not the geometry of the Minkowski spacetime is not only determined by the metric, but we have to specify a rule for the parallel transport of vectors and tensors in general. Now here. For Minkowski spacetime, the connection is Levi-Civita, which means that it is uniquely determined by the metric tensor, but nevertheless, it is there. So this is my four-dimensional Minkowski spacetime. And then I take the cotangent bundle over the spacetime is the space of one forms. It's the dual of the vector bundle. And I construct the algebra of exterior differential forms where omega p of m denotes the space of p forms on m. P form, I'm going to come to that. So in order to ease out the definitions above, let us choose a G orthonormal frame that spans the tangent bundle Tm. Okay, remember we have a vector space. We start with a vector space and we have introduced a basis for that vector space, and since it was equipped with a non-degenerate symmetric bilinear form, we have orthonormalized it with respect to this quadratic form. Now here we have the vector space and it's equipped with a metric tensor, a quadratic bilinear form. So I can introduce G orthonormal frames on the tangent bundle. However, in order to define the Clifford algebra over the Minkowski spacetime, I'm going to prefer to work with the dual vector space. You see that all the vectors on a manifold constitute the tangent bundle. I can introduce a G orthonormal frame that I show by XA. But on the other hand, I can take the dual, the cotangent bundle, whose elements are the one forms or the coframe vectors. So given a frame on the tangent bundle, I can uniquely determine the coframe on the cotangent bundle. So in order to define the Clifford algebra over the spacetime, I work with the cotangent bundles rather than the tangent bundle. I don't want with vectors. Vectors have indices, contravariant indices. Covectors or one forms have covariant indices. So I'm going to work with covariant objects. And they are the cotangent bundle is spanned by the coframe EA, and they are determined uniquely in terms of the frames. So we have to switch to a contravariant metric on the cotangent bundle such that G inverse evaluates two basis one forms and gives me what I call the eta AB, which is minus plus plus. This is an orthonormal frame of the cotangent bundle relative to G inverse. Again, there is no problem. I give you the metric tensor on the tangent bundle, the tensor product of the tangent bundle, TM tensor, tan TM, the inverse metric G inverse exists because I have assumed non-degenerate metric, and G inverse acts on the tensor product of T star M times T star M. So it is orthonormalized. So I have an orthonormal basis. Now, in order to complete the discussion, I have to introduce forms. A zero form is the space of smooth functions on M. And then the space of one form is the cotangent bundle itself. Now comes the space of two forms. It consists of all anti-symmetric second rank covariant tensors on M. So given any two form omega, we can expand it in terms of the wedge product, the anti-symmetric tensor product of the covectors, orthonormal covectors. And omega AB have two covariant indices. However, since the wedge product is an anti-symmetric tensor product of these basis one forms, the anti-symmetry of AB requires the anti-symmetry of this index AB, pair index pair AB. So omega AB has two contravariant indices, covariant indices. However, they have to be anti-symmetric pair. This is, you have to compare this case with the components of the second rank covariant metric tensor. It's a symmetric tensor, but for a two form, the coefficients are skew symmetric in the exchange, under the exchange of pair. So all the two forms can be written in terms of this wedge product in this form. The set of all such two forms is a two form space. Now I can generalize it to a P form. A P form can be on M, can be written as an expansion over the wedge product, exterior product of basis one forms, P of those, take P basis one forms, you can take the wedge product, which means that this is an ordered tensor product, which is totally anti-symmetrized under the permutations of the indices. So this is a P form basis, and then the expansion concerns all terms on such product of P co-basis one forms. And since the wedge product is skew symmetric under the exchange of any co-basis elements, the product changes sign, it's skew symmetric. So the coefficients here are real coefficients, carry P covariant indices. Because of the anti-symmetry of the exterior product, this is an anti-symmetric tensor product of P objects. These coefficients, real coefficients, are also skew symmetric in P indices. And then for normalization, to avoid overcounting, since I'm summing over P indices over this full range, I have to divide by 1 over P factorial. So I have zero forms, one forms, two forms, P forms, and an M form. And I don't have an M plus one form, right? On an n-dimensional manifold, M, the cotangent, on the cotangent bundle, if you want to take the totally skew symmetric tensor product over covectors, the top form is an M form, M plus form, M plus one form identically vanishes, and you don't have any other terms in the expansion. So, well, first of all, there are very simple things to for you to prove. The space of all P forms has the dimension 4 over P, the binomial expansion. Well, I think at this point, maybe it should be, I should remind you, I have assigned you some problems. So for instance, in D dimensions, I have zero forms, one forms, two forms, three forms. The space of one forms, zero forms is one dimensional. It's just the space of smooth functions in three dimensions, Euclidean space. I'm coming back to the example. The cotangent bundle itself is, well, it has three basis elements, three. And what about the two forms? What's the dimension of the space of two forms? In three dimensions, It's again 3. You can check that. An anti-symmetric second rank covariant object in 3 dimensions has 3 independent components, right? Omega 1, 2, omega 1, 3, omega 2, 3. And all the other combinations are equal. So the space of 2 forms in 3 dimensions is 3 dimensional again. Space of 3 forms in 3 dimensions is 1 dimensional again. So you can see the following. Space of 1 for 0 forms has the same dimension as space of 3 forms. Space of 1 forms in 3 dimensions has the same dimension as space of 2 forms in 3 dimensions. So you can establish a vector space isomorphism. 0 forms and 3 forms as vector spaces can be isomorphic. 1 forms, space of 1 forms and space of 2 forms in 3 dimensions has the same dimension. So they are vector space isomorphic. A 1 form and a 2 form has a vector space isomorphism between them. It means that for each 1 form, you can associate a 2 form. For each 2 form, you can associate a 1 form. Well, that's the Hodge map. That's essentially the Hodge map, right? The Hodge map of a 1-0 form is a 3 form. The Hodge map of a 3 form is a 0 form. The Hodge map of a 1 form is a 2 form. The Hodge map of a 2 form is a 1 form. Now, maybe I'm going to tell you something physical at this point. I haven't written down, I'm just telling you. In three-dimensional vector analysis, you have vectors and you have axial vectors. You have scalars and you have pseudo-scalars. Have you wondered what that means? A scalar is a zero form. A pseudo-scalar is a three form. A vector is a one form. An axial vector is a two form, okay? So keep this in mind, right? This is a very simple rule. A vector is a one form, an axial vector is a two form. A scalar is a zero form, a pseudo-scalar is a three form, right? So you can generalize from there, right? The Grassmann algebra of exterior differential forms on N are the skew symmetric product. Under the skew symmetric product is given by this direct sum. This is the exterior algebra over M. So you see that it is a direct sum of the tensor spaces, tensor manifolds under the skew symmetric wedge product, exterior product. Its dimension is 2 to the D. The dimension in a D dimensional manifold over a D dimensional manifold M, the Grassmann algebra of exterior differential forms is 2 to the d dimensional. In 4 dimensions, it is 16 dimensional. In 3 dimensions, if M is 3 dimensional Euclidean space, Grassmann algebra is 2 to the 3, it is 8 dimensional. Okay, you see that this basis is a basis of the exterior algebra over the this is the exterior basis for, it's an orthonormal basis for the Grassmann algebra over the three-dimensional Euclidean space, okay? So I have given you that. It's eight-dimensional, but now we are going to work with the Minkowski metric on our four-dimensional space-time manifold. Now you see that the metric G on M induces a norm on the cotangent bundle. Norm on the cotangent bundle. Well, you have to give me that. The metric on the cotangent bundle is the inverse metric. It eats one forms and gives you numbers. So G inverse acting on x tilde gives you the norm of x, which is x, the norm of x evaluated on the under G. They are the same. And then that gives me the non-degenerate quadratic form on the cotangent bundle, right? So you have to work out these two. I have already worked out all the terminology here. X, Y, etc. These are vector fields. They are elements in the tangent bundle. And then if I have, I'm given a metric, an undegenerate metric, I can raise and lower indices and I can induce index lowering by G, which takes X to its dual one form, X tilde. So this is the notation. if I have a vector field X tilde is the corresponding one form. If I have a one form omega, it's tilde, omega tilde is the corresponding vector field, etc. So this is a useful notation. So the norm induced on the cotangent bundle by the metric on M is given by this G inverse evaluated on X tilde, X tilde. It's the norm. We need this for the Clifford algebra definition. Well, this definition can be extended over to the space of P forms in the following way. Suppose the orientation of M is fixed by the choice of a one form, right? This is the covariant volume element. You have to fix the orientation because the volume four form can be right-handed or a left-handed one. We usually take a right-handed orientation, which is this one. You could have used a left-handed orientation, so we have to be very specific. We fix the orientation. This orientation, this invariant volume element definition, together with the Minkowski metric on G, determines a Hodgman on the Grassmann algebra of differential forms. A P form is mapped onto a 4 minus P form. Now the way to do it is, I'm not going to explain. Suppose that I'm given a P form beta, which is an expansion over this wedge product of P basis one forms with these Q symmetric real coefficients with P indices. The norm will be determined by this summation here. So you see that I have a real coefficient for beta with P lower indices. I raise all the indices with the metric. I raise them up. So I have an object with P upper indices, and then I sum over each index in that order. And again, for avoiding overcounting, I divide it by 1 over P factorial. So this will be the norm of this beta relative to my quadratic form. So this is the norm of a P form beta induced by the metric or the quadratic form that is defined on the cotangent bundle. While using the Hodge map and the wedge product, you can check that this is nothing but beta wedge star beta and then quantity under the Hodge. Well, let us see what do we get. Beta is a P form.
Can I ask a question here?
Yeah.
Well, since we have mentioned orientability multiple times, I wonder how can we define the volume product or any P form on a non-orientable manifold?
I'm not going to define them. I'm not going to use unorientable manifolds in this game yet, right? We are going to avoid it at this point. And
okay, it's irrelevant, I understand.
At this point, space-time and all the physical examples that we consider, we will be working with orientable manifolds. I'm not going to work on something like the Möbius strip, let me say. Of course, that doesn't mean that it cannot be done. However, I'm going to avoid all these difficulties. Let me say it that way. All the physical models, and especially the Clifford algebras over space-time, I'm going to assume that our manifold is orientable. When I say space-time, maybe I should make it more precise. M is an orientable four-dimensional differentiable manifold. All these words carry meanings, right? It's a manifold,
yes, of course.
Differentiable manifold. It's an orientable manifold. And then maybe we have to also specify something concerning their topology. Singularities, do we have singularities or not? Minkowski space time is topologically trivial. It's orientable, differentiable, smooth. It's a smooth manifold. When I say it's a smooth manifold, I'm not going to discuss black holes. That's the meaning, right?
Okay, thank you.
Okay. It's a meaningful question, but I think from the beginning, by specifying the conditions on the definition of the Minkowski spacetime, we avoid those difficult cases, let me say. I think that's the usual physicist attitude, right? When there is something problematic, you put it aside. Okay.
Thank you.
So beta is a p-form, star beta is a 4 minus p-form, beta wedge star beta is a 4 form, and if you take the star of a 4 form, it's a 0 form, it's a number, right? Okay, and it's this number. So here, so we have a norm induced on the space of p-forms, but this norm is induced by the norm defined on the cotangent bundle, and that was induced by the metric defined on M. Right, okay, we have this chain. So when you give me a metric on the Minkowski spacetime, that takes care of everything. Of course, plus I have an assumption on the orientability of M because I'm using the Hodge map. Now, making use of the polarization identity, we get a symmetric bilinear form on the Grassmann algebra of differential forms, right? Okay, so that's the last step. I have also given you the polarization identity. A symmetric bilinear product induces a norm, and conversely, a symmetric quadratic form induces a symmetric bilinear form, right? So I'm going backwards now. I give you the Minkowski metric that induces a norm on the cotangent bundle, and together with the Hodge map, that induces a norm on the Grassmann algebra of exterior forms on the cotangent bundle. And now I'm taking one step back. I'm taking that norm on the Grassmann algebra of exterior differential forms. And from that, I obtain a symmetric bilinear quadratic form defined on the exterior algebra. Now I can give you the Clifford product of two forms. In order to keep the discussion simple, let me stick to vector fields. I don't want to carry these definition with many indices. Let me take just a vector field. Then the Clifford product of the corresponding covectors, which are elements of the cotangent bundle, should be defined, right? Now, how do I define it? I define it in the following way. I have a one form element of the cotangent bundle. It's a very specific type of a Clifford algebra element. Y tilde is again a Clifford algebra element, and this V product is the Clifford product. What's the Clifford product of two one forms? Well, its exterior product is a two form, but the Clifford product is this direct sum of a zero form and a two form, right? It doesn't have to be a homogeneous form, right? The Clifford product of two one forms is a zero form and a two form. It's a direct sum. It's just a formal sum like that. You take the inner product of these two forms with the metric. That's the identity element in the Clifford expansion. And then you take the wedge product. So it's the Clifford product, is the symmetric product, and this Q symmetric product. So if I give you the metric, the inner symmetric inner product, and the wedge product, skew symmetric exterior product, I take the sum, and that gives me the Clifford product. And then I can very funny things like, if you give me matrices, Dirac's gamma matrices, which define a generator set for a Clifford algebra, their Clifford product is just simply the matrix product. And then if you give me the inner product of gamma matrices, their magnitudes, their orthogonality, etc. So I know the Clifford product, I know the inner product, I take the difference and I get the exterior algebra on the Dirac gamma matrices. This way, this is the prescription for you, right? Symmetric inner product and the skew symmetric exterior product used in this way defines me the Clifford product. So our exterior algebra of differential forms on the cotangent bundle over the space, the Minkowski spacetime manifold, with the introduction of a metric plus the orientability, of course, the Hodge map, has become a Clifford algebra, right? At the end, we have a Clifford algebra. And you have to get used to working with such objects here. We are never, when we deal with tensors of a specific rank, we don't add a zero form and a two form usually. but it's meaningful in the context of Clifford algebra. You can add all tensors of all ranks, available ranks, from zero to rank zero to rank n, if the dimension of the vector space is n. Now, I have gone through that. In general, in d dimensions, the metric G need not be of definite signature. So let us define this once and for all. We have a metric with signature, S minus T means that, remember that in a orthonormal basis, when you evaluate the norm of these orthonormal basis elements, you either get plus one or minus one. And then if the basis forms are taken orthogonal to each other, so two distinct orthonormal bases are orthogonal to each other. So when you evaluate the matrix of G in that given relative to that orthonormal basis, it's a diagonal matrix. All the non-zero entries live on the diagonal. Off-diagonal entries vanish because of orthogonality. And then there is no zero on the diagonal. Why? Because we assume that the metric is non-degenerate, so that it cannot have any zero eigenvalues. So all the entries on the diagonal are either plus one or minus one. That's the normalization. So you count the number of plus ones on the diagonal and you count the number of minus signs on the diagonal. S is the number of plus ones. T is the minus number of minus ones. They add up to the dimension D, but the difference S minus T is called the signature of the metric. Now the signature of the Minkowski metric that I'm using is plus two, right? There will be one minus, three pluses. So S is three, T is one. So the signature I'm using is plus two. In quantum field theory books, usually the Minkowski signature is taken to be the opposite one, one plus, three minuses. Well, that's a convention, but on the other hand, in a minute, I'm going to show you that this is not something trivial because the corresponding spin groups will be different. The Clifford algebras will be different for different signatures. So there are some subtle differences involved. And I'm going to construct again for an arbitrary d-dimensional manifold, it could be the non-degenerate covariant second rank metric tensor, the real Clifford algebra. And I'm going to denote that real Clifford algebra by Clif TS. Now, what does this Clif TS mean? T is the, well, T and S refer to the signature. T is the number of minus ones. S is the number of plus ones. So T plus S is the dimension of the Clifford algebra, dimension of the vector space over which you construct your Clifford algebra. And S minus T is the signature that I have shown you here. So for instance, the Clifford algebra that I have constructed, I have explained in the previous page, has a signature minus plus two. So it is Clif 1-3, right? Clif 1-3. When I say Clif 1-3, it means that the metric I am using over this four-dimensional manifold has one minus on the diagonal and three pluses on the diagonal. It should be distinguished from Clif 3-1. Right, Clif 3-1 is different. Clif 3-1 means that the metric will have three minuses on the diagonal and one plus on the diagonal. You can have Clif 2-2, right? Two minuses, two pluses. That's also a possibility, although not we are not using in physics, but we are using in string models as well. So we have Clif 1-3. That's what we are going to discuss. But we can have Clif 3-1. That's also discussed in physics. Clif 2-2 is not something we discuss often in physics, but then there is Clif 4-0 and Clif 0-4. These are the definite signature cases, right? So Clif 0-4 has four pluses, Euclidean. Clif 4-0 is something different with four minuses, right? So all these cases are four-dimensional real Clifford algebras. So that's a setting, the notation. Our real Clifford algebra that we constructed on the Minkowski spacetime relative to the Lorentzian metric that we introduced is this one, right? the vector space we build up is the cotangent bundle, and then the metric on the or the quadratic form on the cotangent bundle. This is V, and this is Q. The quadratic form is the inverse metric, right? And then I'm going to denote this by Clif 1-3 for short. This is the Clifford algebra, real Clifford algebra over the Minkowski spacetime MG with the Levi-Civita connection. Now, in fact, let me say a few words about that one here. I have also added that one. For instance, the Clifford algebra Clif 1-3 is this is also the notation here. When I say mat for R, this is the algebra of 4x4 real matrices. So do you consider the algebra of 4x4 matrices with real entries? So Clifford 1-3 is algebraically isomorphic to matrix algebra of 4x4 real matrices, algebra 4x4 real matrices.
Can I ask a question here? Mm-hmm. Is the matrix algebra also a GL algebra?
Yeah. Well, okay. No. In that sense, we have a metric, right?
Yes.
So it is an SO algebra because of the we require orthonormality with respect to this metric, right? That's how you get from GLNR to SONR, right? So you consider
pseudo orthogonal then, because we got a metric.
Yeah, that's we got a metric. That's essential for the definition of the Clifford algebra, right? But on the other hand, when I write a 4x4 real matrix, that's an element of the Clifford algebra, Clif 1-3, and I can expand it. How many elements do they have? 16, right? 4x4 real matrix algebra have 16 independent elements, right?
Yes, yes, true.
The dimension of Clif 1-3, 16. So, in fact, Clif 1-3 is just a different way of ordering your basis elements, right? I'm going to expand a 4x4 real matrix with 16 elements in such a way that I have an identity, I have a vector, I have an anti-symmetric tensor field, etc. My main point here is that Clif 1-3 is isomorphic, algebraically isomorphic to the algebra of 4x4 real matrices, whereas Clif 3-1, the opposite signature, is isomorphic to the 2x2 quaternionic matrices. 2x2 quaternionic matrices, it's again, the dimension is 16 elements, but of course, with different algebraic properties. The Lorentz group here is SO1-3, Lorentz group here is SL2-C, remember that. All the real Clifford algebras, Clif TS, can be classified in terms of these division algebras, R, C, and H, right? R, we are familiar with, and I have talked about real Clifford algebras. Complex numbers, okay, you introduce an imaginary unit number I, which squares to -1, which takes care of these minus signs in the signature. So you have the algebra of real numbers, the complex numbers. Now you can introduce a quaternion as a pair of complex numbers. That's the Cayley-Dixon procedure. I think everybody who studied physics is familiar with quaternions, but we don't call quaternions. We call them Pauli matrices, right? These are imaginary quaternion units. So when you take any 2x2 complex matrix and if you expand it in terms of the 2x2 identity plus 3 Pauli matrices, what you are doing is that you have a quaternion and you expand that quaternion using quaternion imaginary units. 3 quaternion imaginary units, IJK, are nothing but sigma 1 over I, sigma 2 over I, and sigma 3 over I. These are nothing but quaternion imaginary units. And probably the notation IJK is due to Hamilton himself, who introduced quaternions, and we still use IJK for Cartesian basis for the Euclidean space in our freshman courses, IJK, right? That's history for you. We have RCNH, yani all the Clifford algebra element algebras TS over spacetime with S plus T dimensions of signature S minus T can be classified in terms of matrices with take values on these algebras. This is a D by D real matrices, set of all D by D real matrices, or the set of all D by D complex matrices, or the set of all D by D quaternionic matrices. These three cases, the sets, will cover all the Clifford algebras. So I'm going to give you very quickly the classification. Well, Clif 0, 0, obviously, that's trivial. That's the first term in the expansion of a Clifford algebra element, right? The leading term, space of smooth functions. That's R, nothing else. That's the trivial case. Now, Clif 0, 1 and Clif 1, 0 are different. Clif 1, 0 has an element minus 1 on the diagonal of a 2 by 2 matrix. That's I. Clif 1, 0 is isomorphic to the set of complex numbers, whereas Clif 0, 1 is R direct sum R. R direct sum R is a different algebra. C is a different algebra. Topologically, they are both R2, right? It's just the plane. The algebra elements are points in the plane, but you have a complex structure. The elements are just points on the plane, and that's it. There is no complex structure in the first case. Now, R2, 0, Clif 2, 0, 2, Clif 1, 1, Clif 2, 2, 0. You can check these. Clif 2, 0 with the two plus signs on the diagonal. Now we have a 2 by 2 matrix. This is the space of 2 by 2 real matrices. This is the algebra of 2 by 2 real matrices. But for Clif 2, 0. You need two minus signs, and that's the quaternionic algebra. And then we have the following isomorphisms. I'm not going to go into any discussions. You can check. I have also supplied some simple references for Clifford algebras and spinors. If you check my notes, you will see that there is reference. You can check those, consult those references to understand if you are interested these Clifford algebra isomorphisms. But this tells you that if you know these simple cases, right, inductively, you can work out all the higher order Clifford algebra. So if you understand Clif 0, 0 is R, Clif 0, 1 is R, sum, direct sum R, and 1, 0, and 0, 2 is 1, 1. And if you understand these, you can inductively work out all the other Clifford algebras. So for instance, Clif TS times Clif 0, 2, which you know, is Clif S plus 2T, right? So you can inductively work out everything starting from those simple cases. And there are some further results that extend the list of these Clifford algebras to 8-dimensional cases. I'm not going to go through that. For instance, Clif 0, 3. Clif 0, 3 is what I have discussed as an example at the beginning of this lecture, right? That was Clif 0, 3. And instead, the tensor sum of Clif 1, 0 and Clif 0, 2, according to the above result. And then Clif 1, 0 is the set of complex numbers. Clif 0, 2 is the set of all 2 by 2 real matrices. The tensor product is the complexification of the matrix algebra, which is the space of all 2 by 2 complex matrices. Fine, right? So we get an important result here. If you have the three-dimensional Euclidean space equipped with the Euclidean metric with a plus 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 three definite signature, then the corresponding Clifford algebra is nothing but the matrix algebra over it's the algebra of 2 by 2 complex matrices, right? That's our result. 1, 2 is, on the other hand, is the direct sum of two algebras of 2 by 2 real matrices. Clif 2, 1 well, if you are doing three-dimensional gravity, right, it is depending on the signature convention, it is either if you are doing topologically massive gravity, if you are concerned either with Cliff 1-2, if you use my signature, you will be using Cliff 2-1 if you use the opposite signature, and you see that the corresponding Clifford algebras are distinct, and 3-0 is the other case where the signature is indefinite, definite, but with the minus sign, minus, minus, minus one, minus one, minus one. And then I think there is an interesting Bott's periodicity theorem. That's a difficult subject. I'm just going to mention it for you. Well, I have shown you that if you work out the simple Clifford algebras at lower dimensions, and there are some identities that you work out, which allows you to inductively construct all the higher dimensional Clifford algebras, starting from dimension 0, dimension 1, dimension 2, dimension 3. Then you follow these little lemmas to construct inductively all the Clifford algebras in any dimension. Well, it's a tedious business. I mean, if I tell you that 26 dimensions, what's the corresponding Clifford algebra, right? Well, even 10 dimensions is a problem, right? 11 dimensions, you are constructing gravity superstring theories, right? You are constructing effective superstring theories in 10 dimensions. You are constructing supergravity theories in 11 dimensions. You need spinors to do that, and you need gamma matrices to do that. And we have seen that the gamma matrices are nothing but the generators of a Clifford algebra. So for instance, for 11 dimensional supergravity, you need Cliff 1-10, Cliff 1-10, or Cliff 10-1, whatever. And in order to construct effective superstring theories or even superstring models, you need spinors in 10 dimensions. You need Cliff 1-9 or Cliff 9-1, whatever. So how are we going to do that? Inductively, you can go up to that point. But there is a very powerful theorem, Bott's periodicity theorem, which tells you that there is all the pattern for the Clifford algebras repeat with a period of 8. So if you construct inductively all the Clifford algebras up and including dimension 8, then all the higher dimensions after that repeat the same pattern. Okay, so that's a very powerful theorem in that case. So this inductive procedure is sufficient to be applied up to dimension 8, including 8, and 9 dimensions can be just, you can form a table of Clifford algebras in any dimension, in any table. In some books, you can see this triangular shape, which gives all the possible Clifford algebras according to these isomorphisms that I have shown you, starting from dimension 1, dimension 2, 3, 4, going up to 8. And then after 8, that table stops because you can just fill up the rest of the table to any required value of the dimension. You can read it off from this limited table. This Bott's periodicity theorem, there is a periodicity 8 involved in the definition of the Clifford algebras. I'm not going to give you that one. Okay. I think I have 5 minutes. I'm going to take you. That's the partial list here. You have to fill in between. So for instance, Cliff 8-0, and I have given you Cliff 8, but then there are cases, Cliff 7-1, Cliff 6-2, Cliff 5-3, Cliff 4-4 in the middle.
Tekin Hocam, are you there? Did you freeze? Peki hocam, do you hear us? Okay, I think we lost him. Yeah, well, fortunately, actually, the time was about to. Okay, I guess, yeah. Yeah, okay, he dropped out. Yeah, fortunately for him, he only had like 4 minutes left, so. Yeah, it wasn't like so much, but okay, I think he is back. Tekin Hocam, do you hear us? Tekin Hocam, do you hear us?
Evet, geldi.
Okay, great.
Herhalde bilmiyorum, eskidi herhalde. %100 şarjlı başladım. Bak şu anda bir saatin sonunda bitti böyle. Şimdi filmin şeyini, fişini devam ediyorum.
Tamam hocam.
Share. Görüyor musunuz ekranı yoksa yeniden mi?
Henüz paylaşmadınız hocam.
Peki bir daha share edeceğim demek o. Biraz bir daha açacağım demek. Peki pardon. Bir 5 dakikanızı alacağım tabii bu noktada. Yok olmadı. Çünkü henüz spin-off tanımlamadım, dikkatinizi çekeyim.
Sadece bir dakika kaybettiniz hocam.
Peki, şey çok acele bir şekilde yol göstereceğim. Çünkü spin-off tanımlamadım. Clifford cebirlerini tanımladık. Clifford bundle ve Clifford cebiri tanımlamadım. Ha, şimdi oldu. Share screen. Geldi mi?
Geldi hocam.
Thank you. Okay, so that's the list that you have to complete. This is going up to dimension 8, and then there is Bott's periodicity theorem that tells you how to read off the required Clifford algebra from this table, just from this data. Now, I think a spinor. Let me very quickly restrict myself to four-dimensional Minkowski spacetime. We have already understood that there is an algebra homomorphism which maps the basis one forms of the cotangent bundle to a set of gamma matrices in the Clifford algebra. So the gamma Dirac gamma matrices is nothing but the image of the basis cobasis one forms in the cotangent bundle over the spacetime, which is mapping them to the set of generators of the Clifford algebra. So that's a useful knowledge for you. You may think that where the hell is this gamma matrices are coming from? If I choose a basis in the metric, do I have to change the set of gamma matrices to prove Lorentz invariance, covariance of the Dirac equation, for instance? Well, you see that the cobasis, the coframe, is defined up to a local Lorentz rotation. And since the gamma matrices is the image of the cobasis elements in the Clifford algebra, if you change it basis by a local Lorentz transformation, you have to change your set of gamma matrices in a certain case, right? That's the reason. So that's something nice to understand. The cobasis elements or a frame, coframe, is nothing gives us the Dirac gamma matrices under this map. And then the Clifford product corresponds simply to the product of matrices. Gamma A's are matrices, basis matrices, Dirac gamma matrices. The product of two gamma matrices is nothing but the Clifford product of two one forms, V product. So it has the metric, symmetric part, and the skew symmetric part. This is the zero form, that's the two form. And then the generated basis for the Clifford algebra 1-3 can be given in terms of the 2x2 real or complex matrices, and it is given the basis for the Clifford algebra is given by the 16 basis elements. You give me the identity matrix 4x4. You give me four Dirac matrices 4x4 with these orthonormalization condition. Then two forms is spanned by the skew symmetric product of two gamma A's, gamma A, gamma B. Skew symmetrize, gamma A, gamma B, gamma C, skew symmetrize, gamma A, gamma B, gamma C, gamma D, skew symmetrize. Well, since there is a single one form, you can introduce a gamma 5, a single matrix. So total skew symmetrize product of four gamma matrices is proportional to epsilon A, B, C, D times a matrix gamma 5. Let's have gamma 5. Now, this is a nice exercise for you. one form is mapped onto a tree form is mapped onto a one form. That's the image of the Hodge map. In fact, we have introduced a Hodge map on the space of basis one forms, and that has an image that is given in terms of gamma 5. Gamma 5 is nothing but the image of Hodge map. And then it's not difficult to verify that the matrices gamma AB, skew symmetrized, carry a realization of the V algebra of 1-3. Again, I told you the generators, infinitesimal generators of the Poincaré algebra or the local Lorentz algebra, you can show that gamma A, gamma B, skew symmetrized, I call it 2 sigma AB, and they satisfy the infinitesimal V algebra brackets of the local Lorentz group. So this is the spin 1-3 group. The group generated by sigma ABs is what's called the spin group. And for each Clifford algebra, Clif TS, you have a spin group, spin TS generated in this way. It's the double cover or the spin cover of the Lorentz isometry group of the Minkowski spacetime. This is homogeneous Lorentz transformations. And well, I told you in general, the Clif TS supports a spin group TS. So what's the spinor? This way, okay. The elements of the carrier space of the spin group are called spinors. It's just the section of the spin bundle. So I think for the rest, I'm not going to say anything, a few comments. I have taken the Minkowski spacetime. I have constructed, it's given together with the metric and the Levi-Civita connection and a differentiable manifold and an orientation. I have introduced the tangent bundle and the cotangent bundle. And that over the cotangent bundle, I have co-frame, co-vectors or one forms. And then by taking the skew symmetric tensor products of forms, wedge product of forms, I have defined the space of P forms, and taking a direct sum over P forms, I introduced the exterior differential algebra over the spacetime, Minkowski spacetime. And then using that metric and the orientation, the Hodge map, I have passed from the Grassmann exterior algebra of differential forms on spacetime to the Clifford algebra of P forms or on the spacetime. Once I get to the Clifford algebra, I pick up the action of the spin TS group, the generators of the spin TS group is contained in the even part of the Clifford algebra basis. And then once I have that, I can define spinors because there is a group action, spin TS group action. What's it acting on? It's acting on what's called the spinors, right? So I think this understanding is necessary to start the lectures. Up to this point, we are preparing the ground for the fourth and the fifth lectures. I'm not going to, maybe you should drop the notion that Dirac spinor in four-dimensional Minkowski spacetime is a four-component column matrix. I think it's more than that. It's not a, we are not going to deal with matrices. I think if you can understand the mathematical structure behind these construction, it will allow you to make generalizations easier, right? I'm not going to work with matrices. A tensor is not a matrix. A spinor is not a column matrix or a row matrix. It's more than that. You can represent Clifford algebra elements and the action of the Clifford algebra elements using the appropriate type of matrices, but a Clifford algebra over spacetime or a spinor on spacetime is something more than a matrix. So I think that's the that's finally the comment that I have to make after these three lectures. Next lecture, I'm going to talk about something physical now. I'm going to derive the Dirac equation in four-dimensional spacetime, and then I will prove some mathematical and physical results concerning the Dirac equation. That will be the main part of my lectures. All these three lectures were a preparation for that fourth lecture. Then the fifth lecture is something independent. Okay?
Thank you so much, Tekin Hocam.
You have my notes. You can try to solve problems. Some of them are tough, I would say. I should like to mention that one. Some of the problems are tough. If you have questions, you can reach me.
And I think I should say this in case there are some people who are not aware of this. In the Slack, you can browse channels. Like, you cannot immediately see them in your workspace. So you can browse them. And then you can see the channels that you are not subscribed yet. Like, as I said earlier, we have created a channel for Tekin Hoca, and it contains the notes, and like, you can ask questions there as well, but you need to browse and subscribe to that channel within Slack. If anyone has any trouble doing that, you can contact me as well. And let me stop recording.